Good morning.
Morning.
So good to see you all this morning. Welcome to the final day of Digital Pedagogy Lab's inaugural institute. Thank you guys so much for making this a really amazing week. I tweeted out this morning that I'm feeling unexpectedly emotional at the end of the week. I don't know if I just haven't had enough sleep, or I think it's actually because this has just been—it's really been an incredible week for all of us teachers, everyone who's been involved in making this happen, and I certainly hope that has been reflective of your experience as well. I want to take just a few minutes to get us ready for this morning's keynote, and just say a few things about the week. And I'm going to be very greedy today because normally when, as you've seen, when I improvise, I tend to go off topic and talk funny, so I'm just going to be I talk to leaders every day because every day I am in contact with teachers who have an array of backgrounds, an array of pedagogical stances, an array of fears and beliefs. I hear teachers write about their students, encouraging them, disparaging them, condoning and cursing them, and I hear teachers write about their profession, usually from a perspective of discontent of everything being not quite right. Teachers are spooked by their institutions, they're intimidated by men and intimidated by women, no one is paid enough, and the list of the crises in education seems impossibly long. Tenure and money are not solutions, online education is fraught. Every single person deserves better treatment than they receive. Sisyphus had it easy. But I talk to leaders every day. Teachers are among the most educated of any population. No one receives an education without solving some problems. From dorm roommates who store dead pets in the freezer, to plumbing the depths of pre-modern mathematics, our educations have been about untying knots. And no one comes to teaching without solving even more. We are more skilled than Sisyphus, and not nearly so doomed. I am in favor of speaking plainly, and more bold outcry has become the norm. There is no use in being surreptitious on the internet, nor is there in education. We are not only educators in our classrooms, we are educators at lunch. We are educators at dinner parties. We are educators when we shop, volunteer, and raise our children. We are educators when we write. Tressie McMillan Cotton recently wrote that this moment in time is woefully thin on leaders. I hope they emerge soon, and in numbers plentiful and intersectional enough that it ends higher ed's history of the most marginalized, risking the most for the benefit of the many. Though her article ministers with a forthright compassion to those who are afraid to express themselves, her call to speak out is none too subtle. And she's right. Leaders must emerge. Or perhaps more to the point, leaders must begin to recognize themselves. There are a lot more leaders than we think. We are each better leaders than we give ourselves credit for. And it will be bold speech, voices in the desert that will recover our community of problem solvers. If higher education is ailing, it is only because its many doctors have not applied themselves to its resuscitation. This is not a system that will care for us forever. It's a relationship that requires nurture and aid. The stacks of books upon which our universities have been built molder and decay. The digital makes walls into screens and debates into tweets, yet is less hailed in our hallowed halls. Neither the analog nor the digital will preserve us. We are not a university. Unless we are colleagues, unless we care for the adjunct among us, unless we elevate the student, and unless we make friends as an act of radical political resistance. Josh Bolt has said about the state of education that as of right now, things are not looking good. While we worry about the erosion of tenure, the entire profession is crumbling. It's like painting your living room while the house burns down. He goes on to insist that collaboration will be essential to solving higher education's problems, that we cannot worry about hereditary hair loss when the victim is in a wheelchair. And he calls for help, if sardonically, when he offers, "Tell me how we can accomplish tenure for all, and I will shake your hand." The person who figures out a way to make this happen would be a true hero. Education's new leaders won't be heroes, though. They will be field medics. And we may need to amputate. If what needs to change ever will ride on the shoulders of hard work, determined effort, and not a few more disappointments. Which means we're going to need many opportunities for training, safe places with warm bodies, where new procedures can be tested and learning can occur. Being a leader will not be easy. It will take effort to begin rolling up our sleeves and bending our intellects to the matter at hand. It will no longer be enough to point out the leaky faucet. We must forge the wrench that will fix it. And if anyone can, we can. The Digital Pedagogy Lab Institute is one place to begin. Your classroom is another. And coffee shops and committee meetings, hallways and offices. I talk to leaders every day. I publish leaders upwards of 3 times a week. You can read them on Harvard Pedagogy, or you can write your own words. You can speak plainly your own rebellions. You will write and say brilliant things. Just be sure to let those things raise hell. All of this has not been to introduce Amy Collier and Jesse Stommel to you. It has been to introduce you to all of them. Their voices reside beside yours. Their credentials pale next to the work you have done this week. That said, Amy Collier is Associate Professor of Digital Learning at Middlebury College in Vermont, and she is amazing. Jesse Stommel is an Assistant Professor in the Department of Liberal Studies and the Arts in the Division of Continuing Studies at UW-Madison, who have helped to sponsor this event. And Jesse is also amazing. They may be our final keynote speakers for the Institute, but what remains to be said is what you will say. And with that, please welcome Amy Collier and Jesse Stommel.
I really don't know if I can follow that. That was amazing. Thank you, Sean. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about the game portal. In the game portal, you're in a dystopian world where humans are lab rats that are forced to undergo a number of physical, mental, sometimes emotional challenges, all under the careful and sardonic eye of a super evil computer named GLaDOS. She's evil. She's mean. She's evil. And the only reward, the only motivation you have to go through these trials, these tests, is the promise that at the end, you will get to eat cake. How motivating is that? Would anybody do that for cake? I think, honestly, I know some of us would do a lot for cake, but I saw a lot of cake left over yesterday at lunch, so you guys are going to have to prove yourselves, you know what I mean? Like, this is not a cake crowd, if I'm understanding correctly. So maybe this wouldn't work for you. But in the game, humans are supposed to be motivated by the promise of cake to go through all these difficult trials. The protagonist, Shell, who you are playing as the gamer, arrives at level 16 to start taking level 16 tests, the number 16. But when she gets there, she discovers some writing on the wall. The cake is a lie. This is a turning point for Shell, because this is when she realizes that these tests that she's having to undergo with the promise of cake at the end, they're false. And in fact, up to this point, all the humans who had gone through these trials with the promise of cake had ended up making themselves go into their deaths. The cake is a lie. Now, the cake is a lie has become this meme among gamers. So you may have heard it, you may have actually used the phrase, the cake is a lie. You may have heard people talk about it. And what they mean when they say it is that the goal that you are seeking is an empty goal. Or the motivator that you are being motivated by is fictitious. It has nothing behind it. So I just moved to Middlebury about a month ago. But before that, I was in the Bay Area. And let me tell you that when you live in the Bay Area, you hear a lot of promises from these disruptors. I'm going to use a lot of air quotes right now. Is that OK? These ed tech disruptors who are going to fix our broken educational system with their products, right? And every time I hear these promises, I think, the cake is a lie. When Audrey talked about the problems with viewing education as reductionistic and mechanistic rather than as affective and caring and as complex and multidimensional, that's what I'm seeing happening in a lot of the educational technology that we're dealing with. The cake is a lie. Never mind the fact that a lot of these tools have gray areas around student privacy, are really strange about accessibility, and yet they're going to make us more efficient, more effective, more air quotes. The cake is a lie. Or maybe competency will save us, right? Give us something to work towards, competency-based education. It's very popular right now in policy circles. Is that going to help us? Or is the cake a lie? Or when I see policymakers making policies that say that what we're going to do is change education by setting really, really narrow structures that everybody's going to work towards. Metrics and measurements that are very clear so we all know whether something was of value or not in an educational institution. The cake is a lie. So today, when Jesse and I are going to talk about emergent outcomes, we're going to talk, or sorry, emergent learning. We'll get to outcomes. Emergent learning. We're showing our hand a little bit here, right? We're saying we believe that emergent learning is a really important thing. And what we're going to be doing today is actually throwing out some provocations, three provocations, that we think are related to this topic, that are in some ways kind of low-hanging fruit, right? We could say a lot of things about emergent learning and the current state of where we are in education. But we're going to throw out three provocations because we think these are ones that you might be able to take back to your institutions and have conversations about. In some ways, these allow us to start thinking about opportunities for resistance, opportunities for trying new things at our institutions. And I hope that this will become. I've been talking about this topic for a couple of years now, but it wasn't until last year that it really hit home for me. I have an adorable six-year-old son, and I don't know, if you know this about six-year-olds, but all life's lessons are in six-year-olds. You learn so much from a six-year-old. I've learned so much this year, painfully sometimes, but I've learned so much from him. I was preparing for a talk on kind of learning outcomes and a topic called Not Yetness, which we'll talk about in a little bit, and I had this idea. I'm going to try something with my son. So we took him to the store. We bought him two sets of the exact same Lego kits. He got to pick them out. He picked Star Wars Legos, of course. And we got home, and I gave him one box, and I said, okay, build this box according to the instructions. Okay? So as you can see, this sweet and diligent and very focused little boy, I'm a little biased.
No.
Is building his Lego set. Now, what do you notice about him right now? He's focused. What else?
He's adorable.
He's adorable. Oh my god, yeah, right? He's not smiling. Is he having much fun? Hard to say. He got, as I was watching him, I watched him the whole time, I'm sure he was kind of freaked out by it. As he was watching, he got frustrated a lot. Right? Because these pieces weren't going where they were supposed to go. It's kind of sad, right? I felt kind of bad. So he finished the Lego set. He was pretty proud of his work, but it wasn't particularly an enjoyable experience overall. And then I gave him the exact same Lego set. And I said, now build it however you want. Now, my idea of what was going to happen was that he was going to try to build exactly what he had done before without the instructions. He was going to try to replicate what he had done. But here's what he did instead. Notice how, there's no sound by the way, but notice how he's talking now. Oh, he's smiling. And look, he's making these sounds. If you know a six-year-old, you know these sounds, right? Right? There was lots of exploding happening in this. He's talking, he's making noise. He's playing the whole time. And what he made looked nothing like the original instructions, nothing like the thing that that was originally supposed to be the design based on the instructions. And I was shocked, and as I watched this and I looked back on his mannerisms and the way he changed, I realized taking out those constraints, right, suddenly became a place of play and joy and conversation and places that we would have never expected to have gone if we had given the instructions. So how could we possibly ever go back to the instructions?
So the first provocation. As learners, we can handle a lot more complexity and interactivity than we often give learners credit for. Play is the stuff, the raw material of learning. I've written a little bit about the idea of academic rigor, and I've actually written a little bit about this with my colleague, Sean Michael Morris, rethinking this notion of rigor. What do we mean when we talk about rigor? Do we mean following instructions, or do we mean the kind of ecstatic thing that we saw Amy's son doing? To me, those two videos, we can talk about rigor, and we can talk about the kind of rigor we ask our students to engage in, the kind of rigor we ask tenure-track faculty to engage in, the kind of rigor we ask staff people, adjuncts, people on the street to engage in. And I think that too often, the kind of rigor we ask them to engage in is the kind of rigor that we saw in the first video. For me, when I watched the second video, I saw what I would call actual rigor. I would say that what I saw was ecstatic. What I saw was embodied. What I saw was full, rich. All of the things that I think learning is. All of the things that I think being a colleague is. All of the things that I think being a boss, being a mentor, being a community member are. So I want to talk a little bit now more specifically about what it is that we do in our classes and what we do in our physical classes and what we do in our online classes and how it does or does not resemble what we saw in Amy's videos. So this is a quote from Thomas P. Kasulis, and I've actually had this quote. Truthfully, the entire piece, this is a piece about asking good questions in the classroom. You could Google the entire piece and find it and read it. The strange thing is that this piece is not all that good. It's not my favorite piece of pedagogical, I'm not gonna say that this is the piece you have to read. What it was for me was one of the first pieces that I read about pedagogy, and this is one of the first sentences I underlined in one of the first pieces that I read about pedagogy about 16 years ago. This sentence has stuck with me since then. It has been on every single syllabus that I've ever composed. I read all kinds of stuff. I find all kinds of more wonderful, amazing things, but I've never let go of this. In a sense, this has been the thing that has driven the work that I do in education. He writes, a class is an independent organism with its own goal and dynamics. It is always something more than what even the most imaginative lesson plan can predict. My first semester of teaching, I was up for 2 weeks every night, not being able to sleep. I'm a recovering insomniac. I was thinking about, how do I build this thing? I had never taught in a classroom before. How do I build this thing that will do what I wanted it to do? And for me, it was all about what I constructed in advance, the personality, the person, the thing I was going to be as a teacher. How do I shape that? I read this piece, and I also read a book called by John Holt called Why Children Fail, or it's How Children Fail, I forget. I literally read that book in one read, like until 4 a.m, from cover to cover, and I was just in awe. Essentially, he's arguing that we give people toys, and we let them play with them, and we talk about what they're doing in the room. And we let them discover, as opposed to bringing the learning to them, we let them find the learning in the raw material, in the stuff of learning. And this is what that is about for me. It's about trying to imagine, can I build structures, can I create a space for learning that leaves as much open, as much openness as is needed to create this space of possibility, this crazy, that an organism can inhabit, not a machine. So this is my puppy. I threw this in here partly because I knew she was going to have pictures of her kid. And of course I was like, okay, well, I gotta have my kid in there. I've gotta have that moment where everyone goes, oh, look. The other reason I threw it in here is because I really wasn't that happy with the text on this slide. And I was like reading it last night going, I'm not comfortable with what I'm saying on this slide. So I'm gonna throw a puppy there just to distract everybody so that you won't actually see what's going on in this slide. So, but it's still serving to transition. A well-designed course isn't overly simplistic, but needs minimal instruction. I think the reason why I'm in trouble with this slide is because I'm not sure exactly what I mean by minimal instruction. It's an idea I want to piece out. Also, even just the word instruction makes me a bit uncomfortable. So why would I even want minimal amounts of it? So I really wanted to push on my language, but the idea I want to get to is that we create these learning spaces. And if you were in our track yesterday, we talked a little bit about complexity theory, and we talked a little bit about complexity reduction, about how we create these spaces of learning that are all about making it less complex, making it more navigable, more easily navigable, setting up steps that learners can take so that you know exactly what you're going to expect, exactly what you're going to get out of the learning experience at the end. And I want to compare that to what we actually encounter in the world, where we actually go to learn. This is morning paper. Compare the New York Times site. Lots of stimulus, lots of navigational choices, no patronizing instructions or architectures. You arrive, and I picked New York Times arbitrarily. I don't actually read the New York Times. But you could. The point is that you could almost pull up any of these sites that we go to every day, and they work this way. You arrive on them, and they don't tell you exactly what you're going to get out of that. At the end of your reading experience, you will have encountered X, Y, and Z. That's not what you arrive at when you get to the New York Times. Instead, what you have is lots of density, lots of different information, lots of color, lots of things popping out of you, lots of entry points. Where you start and where I start on this page will be completely different. Where we end up will be completely different. And yet, we still manage to have conversations over breakfast. Did you see that article in the New York Times? So it's not like we're isolated. We have a common experience, but we all enter in one place. We all exit in another place. Another example is Facebook. I'm not a huge fan of Facebook, so I'm picking things that I don't actually engage with all that much, but things that most of us engage with almost on a daily basis. You arrive on Facebook and you're not told where to go first. It doesn't say, start by clicking on the news feed. And that's not your experience when you first sign up with Facebook. It doesn't walk you through the process of engaging in that network in a step-by-step way. So now I want to compare that to the learning management system.
Oh my God.
So, the
Shout
learning
out,
management system. And this is just one of them. Again, chosen arbitrarily. I've worked in every single one. I've worked in Desire to Learn. I've worked in WebCT. I've worked in Blackboard. I've worked in Canvas. I've worked in Moodle. I've worked in them all. Even the ones I like have this feature in common. They telegraph where to go. Your first encounter, your first arrival into the space says, start here. Even if it's not a big arrow pointing saying start here, which sometimes it is. The design is designed so that you start one place and you end up another place. We think about modules. We think about learning architecture. Telegraphs where to go. Everything is in neat and tidy boxes, and there's a limited number of those boxes, and only one kind of thing is in any one of those boxes. There are boxes on New York Times. I understand the need for some kind of structure, some kind of organizational principle, but that's not actually what we see here. The boxes are designed to contain. The boxes are designed to essentially tell you exactly what you're going to build inside of this learning space. In a way, this is all instruction, no Legos. Throw out the Legos and just have him play with the instructions. That's what the learning management system is. Let's see his face when we do that. So the content and engagement density is painfully low. And this is all of our learning management systems. This is also the classroom spaces that we build. The board is at one side of the room. You know exactly where to sit. There's no confusion when someone arrives. No student arrives into the room and accidentally sits in the teacher's desk. The space is designed in such a way that it tells you exactly what to do in it. And one of the things we've been doing throughout our session is talking about how our pedagogy resists what the space is telling us to do inside of it. So I want to show you what we've been doing here. And it's not perfect. This is a pilot institute. And the thing is, we're still inside of a building that's telling us what to do with it. We didn't start with a blank page. There are other institutes like this that are influencing what we do in this space. So we didn't start with the blank page. So I want to talk a bit just about a tweet, a poem. A tweet is like a poem. A tweet can condense what might otherwise be inexpressible into a very small and self-consciously constrained linguistic space. So a tweet has constraints, and yet what I'm arguing here is that the constraints are an affordance. The constraints give you possibility, but it doesn't tell you exactly what to do. You must do this first. It gives you one constraint that says we're going to draw a box around the thing that what we're doing and call it a tweet, and it's going to be 140 characters. We're going to draw a circle around this thing that we're doing together, call it Digital Pedagogy Lab, put some structure into it, and then see what happens, not knowing where we're going to end up. So here's where we end up in the virtual component of Digital Pedagogy Lab. We end up with something that looks like this. And this, for me, is the kind of learning that I want my students to have. This is the kind of learning that I want us to have. Interestingly, I think we have this learning better inside of Twitter than we had inside of our rooms, but I think to a certain extent our rooms still looked a bit like this. Each of these nodes is a person. And that, to me, when we talk about complexity, I think that the complexity that we try too often to reduce is we try and remove people, we try and remove humans from the space. And even worse, we try and remove humans in relationship from the space of learning. And even when we think, when we say student-centered, lots of interaction, lots of engagement, it isn't the kind of engagement that we have at breakfast. The room changes the second that the keynote begins. That kind of ecstatic thing that's happening, where you're at your tables, haven't been told what to do, there's a certain structure in the room. My guess is that you were learning from the second that you walked into this room, but in your brain, you thought, I'm waiting to learn. Learning's gonna happen in a little bit when someone says, now let's get started. Is there a way in our teaching and learning to stop saying, now let's get started? To just have the learning be ubiquitous and to move effortlessly from Amy and I talking after the room to you talking at a table. So what you're seeing here is you're seeing a network, and you're seeing how a network forms, and you're seeing this ecstatic interconnection. The lines are people who have interacted and engaged with one another. On the outside, you're seeing people who have not really engaged with each other, but they have participated in the work that we're doing here. In a sense, you might call them lurkers. I would call them listeners. They're people that are engaging and listening. But what you see at the center is this nested ball where the interactions are completely unclear. What is that thing? And the question I want to ask is, how do we assess something like that? How do we talk, like, is that good? Was there a good interaction on Twitter? Would we give this interaction an A? So I'm going to read a quote from me and Sean Michael Morris. We write, what we need are new ways to read the data, analyzing its poetry where once it had only quantitative character. We need to close read learning data to begin hypothesizing and ruminating on what it means, rather than jumping too quickly and prematurely into assessment. So when we look at something like this, what we talk about, and this is Sean and I's words, we talk about not did learning happen, we talk about, or how can we measure that learning was happening? We talk about what do we see? What do we notice? What is interesting about this image? Also, we think about it more like poetry than thinking about it like sociological data. These are people, these are humans. We look at something like this, we look at a learning environment as though it's a group of humans, ecstatic humans interacting in peculiar ways. So we're gonna take a small pause, and I'm gonna have you interact with the folks I think the folks at your table might have a lot of people at it. So, I mean, find a group of two or three. And I've got a question that I just want you to talk about for about 3 minutes. And you may tweet some responses to it, potentially, and then, you know, we can add some more ecstasy to this space. But that's not necessarily required. 3 to 5 minutes.
I know learning happens when I get a grade. Oh,
when you get a grade?
Yeah.
That's too bad, because I don't like grades.
So we're going to move on to provocation number two. And this is one that I've been kind of working through it a little bit this year. And it's that evidence-based teaching and what works approaches are problematic and do not sufficiently recognize the complexity of learning. And I come at this a little bit from personal experience where, having been working in Centers for Teaching and Learning for the last 8 to 10 years or so, the notion of what works is one that we kind of live by. It's one that it very much drives the conversations that we have with faculty. And I kept kind of feeling really odd about it. And as I've been exploring it more, I think one of the things that I started looking at was that this push for what works and evidence-based practice is very rampant right now. In fact, a lot of people in literature will call this the age of accountability. And it's a really kind of interesting moment. And to look at it and see, there are articles and reports out there that say the US Department of Education, or lots of reports out of UK saying evidence-based teaching is the only way to go. And that we need to be focusing on only tactics that we know will have direct outputs that we can measure and talk about.
Can you tease out a little bit what you mean by evidence-based teaching?
I can't. Actually, you know, let me go to a slide that will tell you that. Let me skip forward for a second. Here. So this is actually from the Evidence-Based Practice Teacher, or Evidence-Based Teaching Network. And they say that essentially we can go to empirical or positivistic lens, where there is a truth out there that can be ascertained through what they call the gold standard research, which is experimental research. And the idea is that there's a direct link between an experimental condition and an output, right? And so what they would say about learning is that what we're in teaching is that you want to apply an intervention through teaching that you'll know will have a specific output. So, and this shows up, I'll come back to the slide in a second. This shows up in a lot of literature that we use with faculty all the time. This is a book that we used in a lot of Centers for Teaching and Learning I've worked in. This, How Learning Works. 7 principles that you can apply to your learning that will improve your learning, or the student's learning. And I think that digital education in many ways has become this promise associated with the accountability movement. Because then you hear conversations like this. So this is from a report of the ACE meeting from last year. And I decided not to use the speaker's actual words. I wanted to use a report of them for a couple of reasons. One, because the people who were speaking, I know kind of personally, I want to be cautious about that. This is essentially the synopsis saying that we can use technologies as great big data collectors. Isn't that great? Isn't that why you want to use digital learning? Because it's a great big technology data collector, right? And I think MOOCs haven't helped us at all either, right? Because when you start talking about MOOCs, here's Anand Agarwal from edX saying, you know what's great about MOOCs is it's tons of data. Now we can start doing the gold standard research because we have large enough sample sizes for experimental conditions to be valid. And what I'm worried about, and in some ways, is that I've seen in many institutions, many of our schools, digital learning actually making inroads at our schools, not because it's a unique and interesting and exploratory and exciting space for learning, but actually because it'll give us data on students that we can mine and use for understanding, here it's air quotes again, the learning. I want to raise 2 primary concerns about the evidence-based movement. One is that the evidence-based movement has really pushed a very narrow conception of what learning is. It has to fit in a particular framework so that we can assess it and evaluate it. And it kind of pushes aside more holistic, more humanistic, and more speculative approaches to understanding what learning is. The other criticism I have is that it's also grossly narrowed how we think about what counts as evidence of learning. And pushing things like positivistic and empirical research over again, more humanistic, more holistic, and more speculative approaches to understanding what learning is. And that worries me a lot. Because we get into this, right?
So.
Yes?
So, evidence, there's always some space for collecting evidence that is not conclusive.
Sure.
And if I were in the business of collecting evidence to prove a point, and I got data that I thought was not conclusive that I couldn't see directly, it would be the impetus for me to go again, to sample again. And I'm wondering whether or not that does not leave me the space to accept speculation as one of the inputs.
Right.
When I go back to check.
It's a great question. And what I want to make sure to say here is that what I'm not saying is that evidence-based approaches or empirical research in education is not bad and should be eliminated. What's happening is that it's kind of being used as the gold standard,
as the only way of
understanding,
versus
using it as one of many methods in a tool set that you can use to understand holistically what all is involved in learning. It's kind of reducing it to an input-output rather than systems and complex interactions and identities and things like that. So that's my big concern. And you know, it's funny because and I love, there's this quote, I should read this quote real quick because it's really interesting. A guy named McClure, last name McClure, says, the push for evidence-based practice is animated by the desire for certainty. Willing to sacrifice complexity and diversity for harder evidence and the global tournament of standards. And I think that's my concern. And I worry about it too, because what ends up happening is you get publications like Academically Adrift that take that and say, you know, say things about education and educational systems based on some pretty limited frameworks of understanding what learning is. And then you've got people like Kevin Carey, who then take that and get op-eds written in the New York Times that directly influence policymakers and people who make decisions about education in a way that is inappropriate. And so that's a huge concern that I have. So when we think about the narrowing of learning to very specific ways of thinking about what learning is so that you can measure it, you can have a direct one-to-one relationship, I always think about this quote from Gardner Campbell, who, if you don't read or know or have seen any of his keynotes or anything like that, go find Gardner Campbell. Anything you can about him, read it. He is one of the most insightful, wonderful, careful thinkers in education right now. He's amazing. He's at Virginia Commonwealth University. Talk to Amy a bit about the other Amy, about him. He's amazing. But one of the things he says that I think is really interesting, he says what ends up happening is we start narrowing learning into these kind of smart human tricks, right? And he says these behaviors specified with a set of what he can only describe as je vous statements or yes sir statements, all rewarding the bon élèves and marching towards compliance and away from elusive and disruptive concepts like wonder and awe, curiosity. So I think this is a really important point to make, that when you start focusing in too much on metrics and deciding about learning based on very specific narrow concepts of what learning is, yes, it gives you a lot of very clear data. And it's interesting that it assumes this relationship between what happens in a teaching and learning environment and the output as being very directly related.
Yes.
And what ends up happening is the outcome then starts to formulate the means. There's this kind of ignoring that the way you expect means to end up does impact the, or sorry, ends to end up, it impacts the way the means happen, right? Those end up and people forget that those are actually quite interrelated. The other thing I'll say, and this is related to kind of what counts and what works. So we're talking about how not only have we narrowed, has the push for evidence narrowed what we think about as learning, but also has narrowed what we think about as evidence of learning, particularly in research. And this is, again, where I think we have situations where people are taking this research that says, you know, very limited things about learning and taking it and saying it's generalizable and that it's, you know, because it's the gold standard of research. And so what you end up with is, again, this is a criticism that was just written this week in Inside Higher Ed. John Warner wrote about Kevin Carey's dangerous playbook and how he's got the ear of policymakers and people who are making decisions about education. And what he says is, the notion that the work that happens inside colleges and universities is indeed an illusion, which is something Kevin Carey says, because wonks, which is what Kevin Carey calls himself, who have never spent a moment teaching an undergraduate class, can't figure out how to measure it, doesn't make it so. What's happening is because we're very limiting in what we consider to be true measurement of learning, then you're getting people who are saying, well, we can't measure it, or there's not a clear thing to measure, so it doesn't count. It's not valuable. So what I'd like to call for is something a little different. What if we started thinking about understanding learning as about greater things, more influence, more excellence, social justice, all these things. This is from an amazing book called The Qualitative Manifesto, which I highly recommend. What if we started thinking about learning in terms of the things that can't be observed? What if we started talking about learning as things that can't be captured in a platform or a data management system or a learning management system? So a couple of years ago, last year, George Valencianos and I, who he's at Royal Roads University, call him George Five, so go look for George Five on the internet. George and I did a study where we talked to learners in MOOCs. And it's funny enough, this was one of the very first studies that was qualitative on what happens in MOOCs. We asked them about their lived experiences. And one of the things that came really clear to us is a lot of the practices, a lot of the things that the learners talked about in their experiences could not be captured in any kind of learning management system or data platform. They could not even be seen sometimes. They talked about things like, I talked to my partner, and when we talked about it, I started to understand things better. That's not capturable, but it was an important part of their learning experience. And the only way we found out about it was by talking to them and understanding the meaning that they were making of their experiences. And that was a really important thing. So I want to finish with just, last year, again, my friend Jen Ross, who's at the University of Edinburgh, again, somebody you should look into, talked and wrote about this notion of not-yetness. And we're going to get to it in a minute, but not-yetness for us is a space of uncertainty. It's a space of underdeterminedness. And it's a space of accepting that what happens in learning sometimes can't be fully understood. And maybe can't have an end, that there's no really end that we're talking about. So how would you measure that end if learning is something that doesn't really have an end? And not-yetness for us was a way in which we could characterize an acceptance of that, a framing of the uncertainty and the willingness to accept that uncertainty. And so what we want to talk about, and we're going to move into provocation number three, is thinking about learning as emergent and accepting that not-yetness means that we have to start thinking about the means and the ends as being tightly integrated. And so right now we've been talking about the ends, the outcomes, the things that people value as evidence. Now we're going to talk a bit about the means and the learning outcomes and the things, the inputs that we're talking about in terms of emergent learning and how those all play into this.
So the thing that I want to get at is I want to think about what are the pieces of our learning architectures, the stuff we've built, the stuff of education that we've built, that we need to push on. Now, again, also not necessarily eliminate, but the things that we need to push on in order to open this space of not-yetness. I like to talk about this as education being not a space of knowing, but education is a space of not knowing. And essentially, how do we honor not knowing, and how do we celebrate not knowing? How do we reward not knowing instead of rewarding knowing? And so here's some things: outcomes, competencies, rubrics, standardization. These are the words that I'm hearing increasingly over the 16 years that I've taught. These are the words I hear again and again, and I'm not necessarily saying any of these by themselves are bad, but what I want to do is push on, what do we think about, what are we privileging when we use words like this? All of these, in my mind, are at odds with teaching and learning. Learning outcomes should be a call to exploration, aspiration, play, and not yetness, rather than Rube Goldberg-like machinations leading to a prescribed end. We're not tricking our students into learning by creating nested learning outcomes that where we map every assignment to an outcome. That's not what makes learning happen. And in fact, recognizing that we can't make learning happen is, I think, really key to thinking about how we open a space where learning actually can happen. So I'm going to go through a few of these and talk about them. I may not talk about all of them or talk about them at length, but these are the things that have started to make me bristle. The notion of outcomes. The notion that I could determine in advance for my students exactly where they're going to end up. And one of the things that disturbs me about outcomes is that I would determine this before I even meet the students. Like, how do I know where Amy is going to end up? I haven't even met Amy yet. How can I predetermine those outcomes? So outcomes for an assignment for me emerge over time through the work of each group of students. If I articulate outcomes too clearly at the start, students are less able to articulate them. That feels really important to me. Like a key moment of learning for me is students answering the question, what did I learn? And if I've told them in advance, you will learn X, Y, and Z, what do they tell me at the end? They tell me, I have learned X, Y, and Z, and maybe a little bit of this other thing. But that's not what I want. What I want is my students to actually be able to engage with their own raw matter of learning and think critically about it. And I think that we haven't been nearly imaginative enough with our outcomes. I want outcomes like for us to have an epiphany or for students to do something I couldn't anticipate. That to me is the stuff of learning. And so often I sit and talk with other faculty about outcomes and we come up with things like that. Maybe not quite, because people don't push quite that far, but we say something like critical thinking will happen. And then immediately the question is, well, wait, how are we going to measure that? How are we going to know that critical thinking happens? How am I going to know that an epiphany happened? Well, the problem is that I can't know that. And so we say, oh, well, I have to throw out that outcome because I won't ever be able to know. And so to me, one of the things is trust, finding a space where we can trust that this will happen for our students and that they might tell us about it or they might not. And one of the things, there was a quote recently where someone said, they said that we spend so much time figuring out how to assess our students, how to assess whether learning is happening. We spend so much time doing that and not nearly enough time just asking them if they learned. Why is that not the key kind of assessment? Did you have an epiphany? And when they say yes, for us to just trust that they did. The goal of education for me should always be better learning and not better assessments. I'm not opposed to assessment, but I really am troubled by when we create learning spaces that are mapped in advance by how we might assess them, rather than being really creative, creating a learning space, and then being really creative to come up with new ways of thinking about how we might assess it. Quality matters. Oh, look, quality matter. I didn't. My QA. My QA department did not
proofread
that slide.
I need to take a picture of that. Just wait. This will be my next keynote slide. Hold on.
Exactly.
Sorry. Pardon me.
So, for me.
We're a learning community.
Just out of curiosity, with each of these, how many people at your campus are outcomes a big deal? You talk about outcomes. Raise your hand. Now let's go with quality matters. How many people have heard this idea of quality matters? So a couple things that trouble me. I'm just going to go through these relatively quickly, and we can talk about them a little bit more during the Q&A. Things that trouble me about the notion of quality matters. The word quality. I think the word quality is really problematic. Quality is political. Quality is ignorant of identity politics. And so when we think about this notion of quality matters, we have to be thinking much more holistically. My other problem with quality matters is it's all about inputs. It's all about if the course is QA'd, if the course has a quality assurance team and there are no typos and everything goes X, Y, Z and everything lines up, learning will happen. Quality matters is not as concerned as it needs to be about outputs, but it's also not as concerned with the messy stuff that happens in the middle between inputs and outputs, which is where I think that we as teachers, like, that's the space that we sit in. Scaffolding. Scaffolding, for me, the issue with scaffolding, I've tried to figure out why I'm so troubled by scaffolding, because I like the idea of taking steps towards some end. My issue with scaffolding is that what we do is we scaffold something in advance. We don't bring students into the process of scaffolding. I like the notion of scaffolding in, like, backwards scaffolding. So something happens, and then you talk with students about how it happened. What did we do first? What did we do second? But I think too often with scaffolding is we build this structure, and then it limits what might happen in the structure, and it's too, like, the first moment of putting a circle around a field and saying, we're gonna play inside this field, that feels like it inspires creativity. But the second that you get, we're gonna play inside this field, and the people over there are gonna play in this way, the people over there are gonna play in this way, and then we're all gonna come together and we're gonna do exactly this, and we know exactly where we're gonna end up, that's where scaffolding starts to feel a little bit absurd to me. Backwards design. Backwards design is, raise your hand if backwards design is a huge thing at your campus. Again, like, I understand the idea of thinking about where do I want to get to? Where am I headed? What kind of trajectory am I on? That makes sense to me. The notion of backwards design as everyone is going to write a 5-paragraph essay. It's going to look exactly like this, and I'm going to backwards design so that everybody ends up in that place. Can we think of, instead of backwards design, can we think of something like sideways design? A kind of design that has us leaving space where people might not end up at the exact place that we expect. Thinking again about trajectories instead of outcomes. Trajectories instead of outputs. Just a couple more, rubrics. Raise your hand if rubrics are a huge thing. The thing about rubrics for me, I'm actually, again, when I think about rubrics, I'm not utterly opposed to them, but the thing that makes me bristle is usually they're written in advance, before you've met the students. The students don't have a role in actually constructing the rubric themselves. I've seen a lot of people do really great experiments where they have students write the rubric. That becomes a much more useful exercise. But the thing is, even just the look of a rubric, the way that it puts everything into neat and tidy boxes as though that's the way learning happens. I look at a rubric and I go, this does not help me grade. This makes my brain break because it forces my brain to put things into weird categories that my brain can't actually do that. And it also, then what is left out? If it doesn't fit in a box, you can't talk about it. Well, to me, all the good stuff, the stuff I really care about, is the stuff that doesn't have a box usually on most rubrics. And then I think this is the last one I'm going to talk about, which is best practices. Best practices, this is a quote from Janine DeBase. She says, too often faculty design pedagogy around the worst case scenario and then apply that pedagogy to every student. The notion of best practices, and this is that 7, what is the book called? I've read it, but there's 7 steps and you will be, and all of your students will learn if you follow these 7 steps. Assuming that I'm the same teacher as Amy, that my students are the same students as Amy's, that my students are the same color as Amy's students, that my students have the same background as Amy's students, all problematic to suggest that there's one set of best practices that will work in every classroom, with every teacher, with every group of students. And so I would go and say best contextual practices, maybe, But it doesn't even go far enough because that word best is troubling to me. Why not? Sometimes good, sometimes they work, sometimes I like them. Ooh, it worked that one time. That to me is the joy of teaching, are those moments when, wow, it worked today. But then it didn't work the next day. And that's fine, it still worked that day.
Jesse, can I interrupt? And we said we were gonna do this, so let's start this banter thing.
Good.
I think one of the things I think people worry about is that's a really vulnerable place to be, right? As a teacher, that's a really vulnerable place to be. But I think it's a really important point to make, what you're saying about best practices and these kind of what works principles. I sat in on a conversation between two professors one time where they argued very vigorously about what was going to make the best classroom environment. One was arguing that it was all teacher-based effects. So it was the teacher's motivations, the teacher's this and that, the teacher's personality, all these teacher-based effects. The other one was saying that no, any person in the world, by applying these seven principles, he was using that book, could be a good instructor. And they argued and argued and argued about which was right. And they both had laundry lists of you know, the perfect gold standard research to support their points. And the entire time I'm sitting there going, I would hate to be in either of your classes. I would feel totally like there was no space for exploration, for fun, for trying things out, because you have a checklist of exactly what you need to do in order to get me to a place that I don't even know if it's right for me. And so I think that that's what you're saying is a really important point to make.
Yeah. And so I'm actually, I was on my last slide and I wanted to end by quoting Amy. And essentially ending by sort of honoring the value of her words inside of mine. That essentially I can't do this on my own. That even the act of us speaking together was emergent. We didn't script this in advance. It essentially emerged in front of you. And so she says not yetness is not satisfying every condition, not fully understanding something, not checklisting everything, not tidying everything, not trying to solve every problem. What's really fascinating is that she got up and she said exactly what this slide says. And that was not planned. And in a sense, it happened as a sort of kismet, and I'm having an epiphany, like literally I'm getting chills up my spine because it just worked out that way, and it wouldn't have had to. So I think with that, what I want to do is I'm going to have us just come up, and I want just to open the discussion. And I want to open the discussion, share some of what you talked about at your group, or ask questions, or just open it up to the floor. We've got about 20 more minutes, and hopefully we can just chat.
So I'm going to, as somebody who knows Jesse and is willing to like push him on things, because I feel like a lot of people might not also really do that for that. And I can do this with love and affection. So I'll contextualize myself. So I fully like am on board with like fucking shit up, right? As a like pedagogical practice. In my like well-rested time, I'm like, yeah, okay. In my teaching my 4-4 with a high composition load to vulnerable students in an institution that may or may not be there tomorrow, I find myself needing to work the system in ways that will be good for my students as well as good for me. And so I want to bring that piece in a little bit, in that that rubrics themselves can be sort of like leverage, that idea of leveraging the nine steps, the whatever steps, the like steps to being a better person. And you know, having all the best friends or something like that. You can take those steps and use that, the idea of using that language to do things that are unexpected, right? I'm as somebody in the institution who is often at odds a lot with the institution, I wanna like get inside in order to like foster rebellion from the inside. So I wonder if we could fold that in a little bit, because I think it's important to realize, particularly for people who may not have power in certain situations, how to do that strategically, and also to choose those battles, right? I'm not fucking shit up every day. Some days I'm just going in and doing what's expected of me because, you know what, I'm tired. Right, so if we could like pull that in a little bit. Well, I will just say yes
because I there was a question there, but honestly you answered the
question.
I'm glad that you did, because I'm doing the worst academic question. No, actually it wasn't that I mean what it was is it wasn't a question, it was a point that that essentially has to be our next point, because this is where a conversation begins to push, but it has to come back to what's possible. What's possible for me, what's possible at my institution, what's possible with my students, and what's possible with how I approach a classroom.
I think something that's happening too is, like, you know, you have these pressures coming in from the outside that are saying, you know, let's continue to make things more normative, let's continue to make things look in particular ways, because that way all particular learning institutions can have the same outcomes, they can have, we can all kind of look at it and say, oh yeah, we know that place is good, we know that place is failing, we know, right? So those pressures are happening, and I think what's important is for the chance for you to kind of push back on that, right? To be able to say, look, there are moments, and maybe it happens within your classroom, right? To come in and say, you know what, here's a rubric, or let's design a rubric. Now let's talk about why we're using this language. Let's talk about why this is an important criteria. Let's talk about the criteria that my department chair is going to hold me to. Now, how are we going to reconcile those things? And talk about those power differentials that happen between the expectations placed on and the push that's placed on the pressures on faculty and students, and what faculty and students actually need in terms of learning and breaking free of some of those expectations. Now, I validate your point, especially about being tired and how this is one of the most trying ways of teaching. And I think everybody, if you haven't, I know the Praxis track kind of started reading the bell hooks, Teaching to Transgress. It is absolutely essential if you're going to be teaching this way, because you watch her go through this exact thing. She says, there were semesters where I didn't want to wake up in the morning. I had set 3 alarms because I was afraid that if I just let myself sleep, I would say, oh, I don't want to go to class, I'm just going to sleep through it. Right? So she experienced the emotional draining that is this kind of approach. And that's something to recognize and talk about as an important part of our labor and our work environments.
And I think open space to talk about that honestly with your students when it feels okay, when it feels all right, and when it's not more draining to do so.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He did have his hand up first. Yeah. I also want to push on Jesse. He's not surprised by this at all. Similar thing that Lisa brought up, but from a different angle. Completely agree with everything you're saying about emergent outcomes and everything. I am, however, a really mean instructor that made my participants in my track work specifically on learning outcomes and designing the assignments. And I also use rubrics. I use all these great things that are also really, really limiting and oppressive in some ways. But I think that in the context of my impression of them being used in the context of higher education, especially in the humanities, is just to put some limits on professors who would teach stuff and just let things go in like 10 million directions of blah, 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 because learning is emergent. And apparently you're going to get something out of Foucault, Derrida, blah, blah, blah discourse and not really saying anything, right? So my point is that I see your point. I also see the point of wanting to offer things like scaffolding, like structure, like learning outcomes. And my group's gonna laugh at me so much also because I by far ran the most unstructured class here, right? But in any case, what I'm saying is that I see these points because these points actually help educators verbalize the meta in learning. We often don't have language to verbalize the meta in learning. And you know, I'm not saying this is the end all. I'm saying, and I agree with you that it's I don't agree with how it's being applied to penalize, but I do think that they've offered us some more specific, graspable, concrete structures to talk about the meta of our teaching and teach more effectively.
Yeah, I think there was a comment back there.
I just want to add on to that that it might be easier to do that in like a literature class, but in like I'm from Texas Women's University, we're big into various healthcare fields, and it's a really literally dangerous thing to try to implement something like that in like a dental hygiene class where like these students' fingers are gonna be in your mouth.
One more comment, Robin, right here.
But I used to always give these presentations where I'd say actually it's especially important for like medical doctors to be trained in these kind of emergent ways because I don't want my medical doctor in 25 years to just be stuck with the contents of that original sort of textbook that one learned. And I used to quote that all the time, of course. I'm a literature professor, so I really have no credibility at all, but I was recently at a conference with a provost from Tufts who is a medical doctor, and she actually said the whole thing, they actually changed their whole med school curriculum to what they call an open curriculum, which is basically OER, so it's all student edited, which means that students who are like just getting into the program, who have you know, no credentials and could not operate on you, are changing the textbooks that they're actually studying. And the idea there is that when they get into the field, they will have the skills that they need to actually sort of learn rather than know, I think.
But they still have learning outcomes.
Yes.
They still have learning objectives.
Yes. I don't think the idea though is that you wouldn't.
No.
One more comment over here.
It just occurs to me that maybe a useful image for this conversation is not so much scaffolding as jabs.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, that's a great point, because I was going to bring up a piece that Sean and I have written, which talks about improvisation within a framework, and we actually do talk exactly about jazz. And essentially it's this idea, so the idea that, I mean, Amy and I are actually pretty controlled. We are actually, I mean, are you type A? I'm type A.
Yes.
No.
Okay. I'm type A. Like, I actually am very structured and controlled, and I actually, part of my pedagogy is to back myself down from that to a certain extent. The way that Sean and I have talked about it is this idea of improvisation within a framework, very much based on jazz, although I'm not an expert in jazz. But the idea is that if you send people into an open field and say, do something creative, whatever you want, they actually will do less creative things than if you put them into a space that has a framework. And so I often do assignments that are very much like reality TV cooking shows. Like, you will make a brownie using only potatoes and cucumbers, and then go. You have 25 minutes. And it's actually very hyper-constrained. And what they do is they're so much more creative than if you just set them out in a field. And I think that this applies to Adeline's comment as well, that there's a way in which you actually, if you're, this is the input-output stuff, if your output is emergent learning, the input is not necessarily no structure. In fact, just the opposite. If your output is student agency, the input is not necessarily teacher giving up all authority in the classroom. Exactly not, in fact. If student agency is your output, teacher agency has to be one of your inputs.
Yeah, I think that I appreciate your caution about quality matters, for instance, and all those things. But I think that what in any conversation, but particularly this one, we have the quality tip of painting broad strokes. You know, because if you want to talk about jazz and abstract art, for instance, you know, Picasso actually learned to put both eyes on the same side of the face before he went the other way. And I would hope that my brain surgeon would know how to do everything up until that point that there's this bizarre bleeder and he has to, you know, improvise to take care of it. You know, so there's place, a place for structure and then a place for improvisation. And I think that even trying to compartmentalize that and say, well, you need the structure first before improvisation is, you know, it's really situation based rather than just something that you can, you know, create a formula for and then adhere to that formula.
I think it's really easy too for us to get into this mode of, okay, here's my learning outcome, and therefore I need to have a really structured way of getting from point A to point B. And, you know, that's a really rigid implementation of learning outcomes. And I think there are ways in which you can have learning outcomes that, again, might be broader, right, might have these kind of curiosity and awe kinds of things to them. You might also have a really specific outcome, but say, while we're getting to that point, we're going to go a little over all over the place. An example, I used it yesterday when I was talking to the praxis track, but I think actually captures a bit of this. Dan Meyer, who used to teach in K-12 environments, he's now a grad student. Actually, he just defended at Stanford. He does this thing he calls, takes pictures or videos that have kind of this unknown element to them. And he takes them to his class and he has them try to figure out what to do with it. And then kind of from there, then figure out the mathematical principles at play. And so an example would be, he has this video of him holding a hose into a giant container. And the video is him turning on the water and the water starting to fill the container. And there's no audio, there's nothing, it's just that. And then in his class, he says things like, okay, what do we need to know? What do you want to know? Like, what are the questions that this video brings up for you? And then they start talking about, well, are we trying to find out how quickly it fills? Okay, if that's what we're trying to find out, then what do we need to know? What are the variables? What are the things? And so the principle is to teach them some mathematical concepts, but getting there is an exploratory activity. Mm-hmm. And I really like that way of thinking about it, as it doesn't have to always be so rigid. It can be exploration around these frameworks.
Yeah, I think about also tangents, about how you could actually have a class that has a very clear outcome and very clear scaffolding. But when I say push on the idea of scaffolding and outcomes, it doesn't mean throw them out. It might mean have scaffolding, have clear outcomes and objectives, but leave space for tangents. Mm. And welcome and honor those space of tangents as potentially useful in getting you towards your outcome. Chris had a point quite a while ago.
Well, and Amy just came back to it with Dan Meyer's examples, because what he does really well with his students is makes them come up with what the problem is that needs to be solved. And that was the thing that I saw with your son working with the Legos that I really wanted to highlight. When he was working with the instructions, his face contorted to show frustration when he was reading the instructions because it was defining what the problem was that he needed to solve. When he was playing on his own without the instructions, he was joyous and happy when he was playing around with things. His face contorted when he looked at the raw materials because he was defining the problem inside his head while he looked at them. And so he was thinking, I now have this goal that I want to create, and now what do I do to satisfy the goal that I've established? And that's what Dan gets his students to do in his classes. And that's, I think, an outcome, is to get students to feel what those processes feel like, to identify problems, to learn how to find those things.
Right. That's great.
Andrew.
I totally love it.
Just one pause. Does anyone hear the questions, or do we need to repeat them back?
Okay,
I'll repeat them. Sorry.
Yeah, I agree. I'm on board with much of this, but I'm thinking about, so we're all heading back to our institutions, having conversations with colleagues who are thinking of learning and education in very different ways, right? And often they're thinking about them in ways that not only have to do with their own exhaustion, but institutional structures, right? Like career advancement and that kind of thing. And they're thinking about them in terms of scholarship too, right? Like what counts of humanity scholarship is my own self, you know, my book under my name, right? And open learning concept is really diametrically opposed to that. And I'm not objecting to open learning, I'm just saying how do you talk to people? How do you talk to people who are, I mean, that is a gigantic, I think that's the biggest shift. Right? Yeah. That's the shift that underlies any possibility of thinking of the rest of this, and I'm just sort of asking for, how do you talk about that? How do you,
yeah. I'm going to try and repeat it, and then I'm going to let Amy answer.
Oh!
So here's my very shortened version of this, which is essentially that we're talking about open learning, we're talking about complexity, and there's often a tension between research and teaching, and doing teaching, not putting energy towards teaching, not counting as research or scholarship. And this sense of open learning makes that gap potentially even wider between research and scholarship, at least in a, from a perceptual perspective. Is that kind of good? Okay.
That is one of the questions I almost always get in reference to these kinds of talks, where we, especially you know, when I talk about not yetness and the opportunity for emergent learning for students to kind of go in places that you can't predict, that are not linear, that are not expected. Mm-hmm. And what ends up happening inevitably is I get two questions. What about tenure? What about accreditation? Those are the two kind of constraints that I think people, there's a tension there between the work that I do in my classroom and how I get rewarded for it, and the things that my institution is looking for in terms of student output and how that's rewarded and validated by accrediting bodies and by, because like for instance, a lot of institutions where I've worked in the past, tenure promotion, although it was primarily based on research, student evaluation data did matter, right? And those were all kind of really closely interrelated. If I had an exact answer to how to solve that problem, I would be famous and rich and president. But
you're already famous. We just need to work on the more rich part.
Listen. Yeah. Ooh, interesting. But I think these are the conversations that we need to have at our institutions about how is it that what is really important in our work. Right, and how does that get validated and recognized? And I don't know how, but we need to have those conversations. And one of the interesting things that I found about when we talk about this matter at our campuses, a lot of times we don't have an answer to this question of how do we talk about this in a way that we can start talking about getting this kind of work validated. But what I do see happening is people in the room start seeing each other in different ways. They start seeing each other as now maybe compatriots and collaborators in an effort. And so what ends up happening is those voices start to get amplified. Those voices start to unite. So I was talking about it one time at a conference, and a colleague came up to me and says, I was sitting across the table from someone from my institution who I never would have thought would be on the same page about this. But as soon as we started talking about it, we started to realize we had a lot of connections around these questions, and we wanted to bring it up at our institution. And now there were two of us, and then there were three of us, and there were four of us. And it started to raise that question and these issues that we have to address into a greater voice, a set of voices.
Maybe the thing is that we talk so much about what counts, and I find myself in so many of those conversations about what counts, and we don't talk enough about what matters. Mm-hmm. There's a can back there. One more question, and then we're gonna break.
Oh, please let it be something.
Okay. Anybody else?
Chris and I still.
Okay, let's do one more, Steve.
So I want to kind of bring up a couple points that I think have already been made, and maybe so I hope it's not repetitive, but that I really like the example of the Legos and the experience of them. It ironically fits very well with all the pictures and the slides this week with all the Legos. And I guess I'm just thinking about that example and really how, from my perspective, that both of those experiences are incredibly valuable, but for very different reasons. And I think this is something that has been touched on in a lot of these other comments about the content and the material, and it sort of parrots the idea that, you know, and I don't mean to parrot it, but that we want our doctors to be trained in actual medicine and not just think creatively and put us together in a different way that we can't survive. I mean, there are real practical reasons why we need to follow instructions, even if, in fact, the jazz is really important. I like that metaphor, too, and I think, you know, I think about being a very amateurish musician that I needed technical skill in order to learn how to improvise. Mm-hmm. So both of these things are not mutually exclusive. I think they're both very valuable, and I guess I wonder how we can craft our pedagogies in ways that provide room for both of these things, and that I think that also means how do we talk about these things in ways that provide room for both of them. And to me, this gets to the essence of sort of balancing the theory and the practice to pursue this praxis that we've been, in our group at least, talking about all week. So I wonder if you have thoughts for like how we can create spaces both in the classroom or how we might define that, as well as in our conversations and our thinking about this, to really balance these things without overcorrecting in one direction or another.
Mm-hmm.
That's a great question.
I almost feel like we do this work here, and it's very intense, but we don't actually do that work until 3 months from now. There's almost this effective labor that we go through here that doesn't, it takes time to sink in. It's one of the issues that I have with measuring learning at the end of a 10-week course, is that we won't actually know if that student learned anything until 3 years later. That's how my learning happened. I didn't know that I got anything out of my graduate program until at least 4 years afterwards. And the thing is, at the end, I would have said, I think I did. I mean, and so it's this sense in which I don't necessarily know. So I talk about praxis as recursive, that you're constantly moving back and forth between philosophy and practice. But I think what you're talking about is this space of reflection that only comes with time. And maybe there's not enough time, I don't know.
Can I add a quick thing?
Yeah.
I just went through my tenure process, and one of the most exciting things, is doing tenure narrative, ever exciting, but that at my institution, they track down students, previous students from 3 or 4 years ago, and those evaluations were pedagogically probably ultimately in a lot of ways more useful than my semester evaluations. So there are ways that institutions are doing this, right? That's a way to find that out.
Yeah, we won't know what we learned at this institute until next year when we're having this institute again and talking to each other. I think that's the key for me.
I think adopting a stance of reflective practice is a really nice way to do that, right? Because it's possible that you're going to design something and it's going to look exactly the same as what you've done before, and it might look, has these structures that you've put into place, but as you reflect on it, and maybe even talk to your students about it, right? What here really did you feel like you flourished in? What gave you a chance to be curious and excited? What made a difference in your life? Not just was content that you learned, but what really changed your perspective on this topic or helped you to embrace this topic in a way that we hadn't thought about? Or what could we do to do that? And that's like you were saying, it's a recursive process, a reflective practice. And I think that's something, it's a stance that we can all take. I know when I first started teaching, when I first started doing instructional design, I was very, very rigid about how I approached it. Partly it was because I didn't know what to do. But over time, through reflective practice, I've slowly worked towards a variety of approaches.
And at least for me, part of that work has to be collaborative.
Yeah,
it has
right.
to be dialogic. It has to be in conversation. The reason Amy is here is because I started to write my keynote and realized I couldn't give it by myself. Realized that she was inhabiting the work that I was doing so fully that I had to invite her. So she was invited after we had already made the plans about who the speakers were, because I realized I couldn't do this by myself and needed to have her voice inside of mine, in conversation with mine, in order to do the work that I needed to do. Otherwise, it would just be me presenting to all of you. Instead, I learned from this experience. And so I'm going to end on that note and ask for a round of applause for Amy.